We're excited about today because not only are we going to talk about different policy, we're going to have technology demonstrations, we're going to talk about the network security that is needed, and obviously the whole underlying fact that broadband is a really key component. Got a really diverse group. I look across the room and I know a number of you. We've got some of our NTCA members who are here in the room. We have some healthcare academics, we've got vendors, we've got associations, we've got some organizations that really just care about rural America. And obviously the health of their population is top of mind for them as well as some folks that we've got from Capitol Hill and from the government. So I think this is an opportunity to have some great discussions, and what I'm anticipating is that our breaks are going to be just as lively as the sessions themselves. So one of the things I am really honored to do this morning is to introduce our keynote speaker to all of you, and that is Senator Shelley Moore Capito from West Virginia. I could go through her normal bio, but I think the really important thing to share with you about the senator, aside from her years of experience in both the House of Representatives and now in the United States Senate representing West Virginia, is the passion that I have seen from her on broadband and what it can do and how you can utilize it. And she is always state first, always thinking about what can some of these things bring to the people I represent in West Virginia. A lot of passion. She's been the founding member of the Senate Rural Broadband Caucus, which I think has already done some pretty exciting initiatives in its first year underway. And I think she also is somebody who I admire greatly because she really has that bipartisan spirit. How do you reach across the aisle to actually get things done? So with that, I'd like to go ahead and turn over the podium to the good senator, and please join me in welcoming her with us today. Thank you.
What a great topic, and what a great time, I think, to really seize this as a topic, as an area of interest, as a way to get people back working again and getting confidence back in the economy. There's no better way, I don't think, than delivering high-speed internet broadband services with a new administration, a new Senate, a new House, sort of wiping the slate slightly clean, never be all the way clean here in Washington, D.C., that's for sure, but to get some really good initiatives. So I'm gonna tell you a little bit about why I'm so passionate about this. Shirley mentioned that, and she's absolutely true. I've represented the state of West Virginia, which is one of the most rural states, even though we're very close to Washington, D.C. We also have economic challenges in our state. We also got a lot of mountains in our state. Somebody said if you iron the state of West Virginia, it'd be as big as the state of Texas. We won't tell, you know, all those Texans who think nothing could be as big as the state of Texas. So we have a lot of challenges, and some of the challenges you see have been manifested in our lack of broadband internet access. When I began running for the Senate in 2014, I was in the House for 14 years. That sort of broadened out my own horizons because I only represented a third of the state. All of a sudden, I'm going around the entire state and realizing just the pockets of non-service that still exist. I live in Charleston, the capital city. You know, when you're doing okay, when you realize you've got your service and it's very reliable and it's affordable and it's accessible, you kind of forget until you start really driving around and talking to small business owners and talking to community health centers, doctor's offices and others, how much more we need to do. So I think about it in terms of broadband access. I think about it sort of on a three-legged stool. For my state, we've had a tremendous downturn in our coal industry. I know we've got some Eastern Kentucky people here who understand what that means. We've lost tens of thousands of jobs. We are in a recession, and six of our counties are actually in a depression, which has been very, very difficult. And we are being asked to transition. How can you transition if you don't have one of the tools of infrastructure to be able to bring about economic development? So economic development for me is probably the number one reason why I'm so passionate about this issue. But the other issues are education. Think of these children in the more rural areas when they are on the bus, when they're going home, they've got an assignment, they've got an iPad, or maybe the school's able to give them iPads. That's happening all across America. They get the iPad, they go home to school, they can't connect. They come to school the next day, they're behind. It's not fair, it's a fairness issue. So this digital divide in rural America, I think, really hits education. There's a lot of innovative ideas out there. Put wireless on the bus, or check out hotspots from the library that you can take home and then access. So there's a lot of people that are trying to figure that one out. But for us to transition our economy, we've got to have an educated workforce. And in order to do that, we've got to educate them to the next jobs, the next technologies. And so education is a reason that I'm very passionate about that. But then telehealth, which is the topic that you're here today to talk about, is number three, healthcare. How we have several major health systems in West Virginia, WVU in the more northern part of the state, Charleston Area Medical Center, Huntington, so I'd say three, Beckley a little bit. But then we got the whole rest of the state that is, unfortunately, we have a lot of people who have serious health needs that have low economic issues, and they're elderly in a lot of cases. They've come back to West Virginia to retire. They're back on the family farm. And for them to drive to Morgantown could take 3.5 hours in a small state like ours. So in a large state, it can be even more challenging. So for me, telehealth, I think, has all kinds of the delivery of through telehealth has great health outcomes, but it also is education, because you can educate your professionals through telehealth and empower your people in your community health centers, where more accessible to those living in the rural areas, and also expense. I mean, I think the delivery of health through telehealth, I think, can be one of those ways that we always keep trying to find ways to contain healthcare costs. I think this is one of the ways that could actually help to do that. So I really want to thank you all for what you're doing now to deliver this, and what innovative ideas that you're wanting to come up with to make this bigger, broader, faster, cheaper, and more accessible. And so, you know, some of the statistics from the FCC are is that 1 in 10 Americans lack the access to FCC's definition of broadband. But in rural areas, it's 39%. Now, I've had my questions with the FCC on how they're actually measuring this, because the last measurement we got from the state of West Virginia said that 56% of West Virginians in rural areas, which is the entire state, 56% did not have access to high-speed internet. That's over half the state. But now their new one, they came back and said, okay, maybe it's not quite that much. But we still have questions about, have we made these big leaps, that what kind of speed is being delivered? How fast is it? What can you really do on it? How reliable is it? Does it work all the time or just some of the time? Is it slower at times of the day and other times of the day? All those kinds of issues that I know that you as providers have tried to tackle. So we turn the page. We've got a new president. President-elect Trump has said that one of the things that he's going to do or wants to do is a massive infrastructure endeavor bill. I think all across America, we're all saying, sounds good to me. There's questions as to how much it would be paid for, what it would do, and what it would address. But I just recently wrote a letter to President-elect Trump and said, any kind of infrastructure bill must and should include broadband as part of your infrastructure. Broadband deployment and broadband expansion, particularly into the rural areas. So don't just fix my bridges and my dams and my locks and my airports. Although I will have to agree, if anybody's here from Chicago, I'm sorry to hurt your feelings, but that airport really needs help. And LaGuardia needs help too. You don't need to mess with my airport, because I can get through TSA in 5 minutes and to my gate, which is only 5 gates, in another 5 minutes. So I'm doing okay. But I was going on a trip from Charleston, West Virginia to Des Moines, Iowa to campaign with Chuck Grassley. Is anybody here from Iowa? Yes, he's such an interesting, we had a great time, interesting guy. He has to go to Dairy Queen every day. That's maybe the key to long living, is hit the Dairy Queen every day. And so if you're coming in from West Virginia into Chicago, you're at gate Z46, because there's only one flight a day. And if you're going to Des Moines, you're at gate A1. I don't know how how, if you're disabled, you get through an airport like that. And it's real narrow in through there. So I'm all for fixing our airports. So I wouldn't want to take away from that, but I do believe, and we've made clear to the president, that broadband deployment is one of the things that he has to include. And we've had conversations with Vice President-elect Pence, the president's transition team, to this effect. So I need your help. You all approach your members, your senators, and your House members to re-emphasize this, because I have a feeling this is something that's going to come down the pike pretty quickly. I talked with the incoming Secretary of the Treasury, Secretary Chao. She is very much aware of this. It doesn't really fall under her bailiwick, but she will play a major part in any kind of development of an infrastructure bill. So I'm excited about that, and I hope that the president can get that off the ground. It'll be a unifying endeavor, as long as we can get the pay-fors where we need to get them. I don't think anybody wants, like, the stimulus plan, another $12 trillion stimulus plan that didn't really expand or sustain the economy and also borrowed another $1 trillion. But we can figure that out as we move forward. Earlier this year, Shirley mentioned, I started the Rural Broadband Caucus. It's bipartisan. We have Senator King from Maine, and I just met somebody from Maine. We have Senator Klobuchar from Minnesota, and we have Senator Bozeman from Arkansas, and we have Senator Heitkamp from North Dakota. Well, I kind of thought, you know, Minnesota, they couldn't really have a big, you know, I always think of Minnesota as bigger cities, but they've got a whole lot of rural all in between these large cities. And we all have the same kinds of problems. We all have people who are, we have lack of competition in West Virginia is one of the things with providers that provides a challenge for all of us. But anyway, we've had a couple meetings trying to find out innovative ways to deliver broadband, to find out what like problems that we have, and we're going to plan, and you all have played a, Shirley was a participant in one of our panel discussions, and it was, I thought, was really good to figure out how to finance a lot of this, because we know that it's expensive. One of my providers said to me at one point, as I was expressing my frustration, well, Shelley, it just takes time and money. I'm like, well, I'm not a rocket scientist. I already knew that. But, you know, let's figure out how to shorten the time and get more money. I mean, that's going to be where the key is going to be. We just recently passed the ECHO Act. Are you all familiar with the ECHO Act? It does deal with telehealth. And I think that it recognizes the need to advance telehealth in our rural communities. It requires the study of innovative continuing medical education that uses video conferencing. Remember I said it's not just about healthcare, it's about educating your professionals. Certainly if you had a special case, you could tap into your professionals at the WVU hospital, and you could be sitting in Pendleton County being able to deliver better service, better outcomes for your patient. It's good because it helps our rural communities. I had Commissioner Clyburn from the FCC to Morgantown, and we went out to Preston Memorial Hospital to talk about the very thing we're talking about, delivering rural health and affordable broadband, and it's a small rural hospital. I was amazed at really how advanced they were in their technologies, but also how they've already moved forward. They're affiliated with the WVU hospitals, and that probably has a lot to do with it, because the universities can drive that innovation. But she talked a lot about how important it is for us to expand internet access to make sure that we can get the telemedicine that we need. I also visited a CAMC. I'm from Charleston, which is the Charleston Area Medical Center, and I participated in their diabetic retina camera demonstration. Has anybody done these? Yes. So what it is the doctor sits, the ophthalmologist is in Charleston, which is our more urban area, and we drove out to Clay to our community health center there, which is about an hour. What doesn't sound like a long ways, but if you don't have ready access to transportation, or if you're in really poor health, it's a long way. And if you have to do it more than, you know, frequently, why do you have to do it? I mean, if you can do it a better way. And what they did was they set me up on the camera, took a picture of my eye, and the ophthalmologist could then read it in real time, and I could react with the ophthalmologist on the you know, it was kind of a Skype kind of thing where we could talk back and forth to see if he saw any problems. He could identify them there. He could give me advice. He could give me maybe some treatment options, refer me to another physician, whatever I might need. And it was just so efficient. The clarity and the resolution to the camera and the image that was transmitted was very clear. It wasn't like, you got to do it again. Can you move this way, that way, like it was when I went to the dentist yesterday. But and it was very, very good. So this kind of deployment of this technology in all our community health centers, I think, could really, really. And it didn't take a whole lot of time. They got a grant, a small grant to be able, and I can't remember who their grant was from. Victoria, do you remember who their grant's from? Victoria's in the room here somewhere. Yeah, I can't remember who their grant was from, but they got a grant that bought the camera, so the hospital didn't have to bear the cost, the doctor didn't bear the cost of the camera, and then there was a bit of training that came with it, and very efficient, very efficient. I just also recently joined with Senator Gillibrand from New York. Are there any New Yorkers in the room? Oh, that's good, because I dumped on LaGuardia, sorry. And what we've worked on here is also, again, trying to open up availabilities of money, time and money. This is through the USDA, the Rural Utilities Service. It will help us with expand the resources from not just a lending program to a grant program for those communities who are underserved or have more economic challenges. So we're the recognition of where we are to try to join with you all as partners to make it better, more efficient, better delivery, and more fair for the rural areas is something that I think has the attention of many of my fellow senators. I mean, if you think about New York, you don't think about, you know, the rural areas of New York. Again, you think about the urban areas, which I'm sure their speeds are great and they're doing a great job, but there's a whole lot of New York in between that doesn't have the kind of service. And Senator Gillibrand, who's a Democrat, and I have joined together for the delivery of that. So, you know, just my state of West Virginia alone, and this will tell you why my passion, we're ranked 48th nationally in broadband accessibility. And it's remained unchanged for a decade. We've stayed at the bottom, and we're still at the bottom. So my goal as the senator is to move us, because it's going to be measurable. The problem is, I hope everybody else is moving at the same time, and we're all moving towards the same goals. Some of the things are burdensome regulations. We have a dig once law. I think Cory Gardner has a dig once piece of legislation out there. So if we do get to this infrastructure bill, and we are going to be building new roads, or we're going to be laying new pipe, let's lay the broadband fiber at the same time, instead of digging once for the road and then dig the road up and lay the fiber later. How costly is that? I understand 90% of the cost sometimes is trying to get through in and around roads in terms of trying to lay your fiber. We also had Commissioner Pye, who's also on the FCC. He came to a rural part of our state to talk about this very issue. We had our hospital there. Another aspect of this is tourism. We learned this is where the New River Gorge Bridge comes down. Has anybody ever done whitewatering on the New River Gorge Bridge? Yes, it's quite an adventure. It's great water. It's supposed to be the best whitewater, I'd say, in the United States, but at least on the East Coast. And a lot of people who come and want to do this, they want to come, they want to do it, they want to stay in a cabin, and when they get home to their cabin, they want to stream, or they want to catch up on their emails, they want connectivity. Even though they want to be unconnected, they want connectivity at the end of the day. And so that's been another challenge for us as well. So Commissioner Pye had some really good ideas. He talked about the dig once, he talked about how states could really help with the delivery of this a lot better. And I don't know how many of your states are incenting you or moving you towards the telehealth issue, but our state just expanded the Medicare under the ACA, and we have 180,000 more people on Medicaid. If we had a good and vibrant telehealth system in all of our community health centers, we could really maximize the delivery of that service to those newly insured, and you'd get paid for it, and at least with Medicaid dollars, which is better than either unpaid or somebody going to the emergency room when they really don't need to. So I think it would be good for all of us. So I'm really looking forward to working towards eliminating our digital divide. And I'm going to talk about just generally, because this is probably, I've been talking about things that you already know a lot. What's the tenor? What's it like in Washington? What's it going to be like in Washington? And what's the new Senate going to be? Well, the new Senate has a new minority leader, Chuck Schumer, and I think that's a good thing. I think Senator McConnell is my leader. He's done a great job. I have great admiration for him. He is the most tight-lipped person I've ever met in my entire life. And for any women in the room, you know how frustrating that is when you can't get the guy to talk. And he doesn't. That's why he's done so well, I think. He's very, yeah, you're laughing over there, Shirley. You've probably tried to pry a few things out of him yourself. And so he keeps his cards very close to his vest, but he is a student of the Senate. He knows the procedures and the pathways forward. And I do believe that the gridlock that we've seen over the last several years, I do believe we're going to see a lot better outcomes with Senator Schumer as the minority leader. Senator Schumer is known very well on Capitol Hill around the country as somebody who wants to get things done, who's a deal maker, who's willing to give and take, because that's what you have. You can't have everything you want all the time, every time. And Senator Schumer, so I'm hopeful and I am optimistic that we're going to get some positive things off and running. Not to say we won't have our partisan issues. Some of the first things we're going to go to is we're going to repeal the ACA, probably at least write the instructions to repeal the ACA right in the beginning, which is the Affordable Care Act. We are also going to be going to nominations, and you can see if you watch TV, which most of us do, I would think, that some of these nominations are going to be controversial. That all goes through the Senate. That'll be a new role, really, for me, because since I've only been there 2 years, we've only done a few confirmations. And then we will probably, as we move into the March time, do the Supreme Court nomination, which will be highly partisan and, I would imagine, very, very volatile. So that will be an interesting. I have no idea who the pick will be, and obviously the president-elect hasn't done that yet, but I would imagine, since it's a 4-4 deadlock in the Supreme Court, it's a pivotal position that's going to be filled as the next justice, and I think you'll see that reflected in the debate on the United States Senate. So after spending 14 years in the House of Representatives, many people would ask me, what's the difference between serving in the House of Representatives and serving in the United States Senate? For all the women in the room, there's only 20 women in the Senate. We ask new countries when they're developing to have 45% of their representatives be women to reflect the population, and when we ourselves only have 20%. But we're powerful, don't worry. We get our voices heard pretty well. But the difference, the story I tell about the difference between being in the House and being in the Senate is the difference between going from junior high to high school. Now, we've all done this, so we remember what it's like. And if you have kids, which I do, I went through it 3 more times with them. You never want to leave junior high because you know your friends, you know your way around, you know how to get to the bathroom, you know the teachers, it's all planned. And so you say to yourself, my kids would say, I don't know if I'm ready to go to high school. I don't know that I really want to go to high school because I really like where I am and it's good. And then the first day they get to high school, they look back at the junior high and they say, see ya. So that's kind of what it's like going from the House to the Senate. I didn't want to leave the House. It was great, but I wanted a bigger challenge. I wanted more power, which the Senate gives you. I wanted to be able to represent the entire state. And once I got there, I turned around and looked at my House friends and I said, see ya. Have a good time. So it's a real honor to be in the Senate. It's a incredibly historic. This is an historic time. I think our electorate, lastly I'll say, I think our electorate said, we're ready to shake it up. We want something different. We're willing to take a chance. The status quo hasn't been working for lots of parts of the country that sort of have gotten flown over and driven through. And I live in that part of the world. And so I'm hoping for good things because I think opportunities are going to come. I think the unpredictability of the new president-elect in some ways will be frustrating. But in some ways, I'm the eternal optimist, is going to be a good thing because I think it will challenge all of us to find a way to find that middle ground to make things work. He's a business person. According to him, he's made deals his entire life. I think he wrote a book on it. A lot of this is about making deals. And I think in order to get my region of the country back working again, and your region's back working again, and rural America working again, we need to put the focus on those people who have felt that they just haven't had a fair shake. So thank you all very much for listening. I'll take questions if you want. If you have time, that's fine with me. And good luck the rest of the day. Any questions? Yeah.
In West Virginia, you're talking about how difficult it is to get broadband out to the areas. Are you primarily served by large carriers, or do you have quite a few smaller companies?
We have a couple small. One, I think, was here yesterday. Hardy Telecommunications. We have Seneca Rocks. We probably have, I don't know, maybe four, but we are primarily served by Frontier, and we don't have much competition, and that's an issue. I'll just give you an example. I was on the flight this morning with a guy who works for a major company who moved back to West Virginia because he wanted to come home, but he really had been living in Atlanta, but he wanted to live near his family and home, and he has to use satellite. He can't even get any high speed, and he said it's very unreliable, it's expensive. And I mean, he's not even in the hilly, woodsy part. He's in between Charleston and Huntington, which are two of our urban areas. And then he told me on his cell phone when he has to make calls, he has to put the phone up by the window. Well, you're nodding your head because you know what I mean. And so that's a challenge for us as well. Yeah.
You mentioned the FCC. So the FCC is trying to push more providers to go after funding, like USAC funding, so that they could get that last mile. So if there's fiber in the area, they're able to connect to that. The problem is that a lot of these local telco companies are not getting incentivized for these small onesie twosie type providers. How can the FCC or USAC or the local telcos get more excited about providing that last mile to these providers? Because really, like you said, they need that help to do work into the patient's home, especially if they can't walk or they can't get transportation.
Mm-hmm.
Your thoughts?
Well, I mean, I think there's a lot of avenues. For instance, in Appalachian region, there's the Appalachian Regional Commission dollars, which are federal dollars, which you can, which I think we should, we've always been trying to get pinpointed towards rural broadband development. It's been usually traditionally used for water and sewer development, which there's still a lot of need for that. So USDA, we just opened that up for grants. I think that would be an avenue. I've had meetings with Google and Microsoft's and Facebook and some of the big, tech companies to try to. It just frustrates me when you read that they're going to Africa and they're going to connect Africa, or like my own John Chambers from West Virginia, he's going to go connect all of India, and I'm like, John, why don't you connect West Virginia first? And so I'm frustrated by that some of our American, big American companies are devoting a lot of, and it's all good. It's not bad. It's all good. But I think, I'd like us to see us look inward a little bit more with some of these private companies who have big dollars and who are going to invest. And so we're working that angle as well, and I think that could be another avenue for financing. We're also working in and I don't know that this would work in this instance, but to open up this small markets tax credit, which is a tax credit for underserved areas to open up the types of areas that would be available to be able to get these dollars. Investors really want it. I don't know if the projects are quite big enough for it. It's a complicated procedure, but it is a way to get access capital. Well, you guys have a good morning, afternoon. Merry Christmas.